This looks better than you.
2 years ago, I told head chef Lewick to simplify his menu and he'd get a Michelin star. So has he changed his ways?
Set up!
A fucking porridge, Joe's. Foie gras.
I don't think so.
One insult to porridge.
Now it's a strange hybrid of Franco-Scottish cooking.
New dishes on the menu? Marinated calamari, potato foam, salted peanut ice cream. And I'd love to see a giblet.
Club sandwich. Yeah.
Scotland, home of the brave. Home too of haggis, neeps and tatties. And the deep-fried Mars bar. But in Inverness, there's a restaurant on a mission to bring sophisticated French cooking to my fellow countrymen.
OK, you send me 2 prestata right now, please.
Yes. It's the vision of French head chef Loïc Lefebvre, who's trained in some of the best kitchens in France.
I went to work for the president in France, Mr. Chirac. When we had, like, Mr. Bush is coming, or Japanese president is coming, used to do, like, big function.
Service, 1 seabass, 1 bread, table 14, go.
Then I moved to work with the Porcel brothers in Montpellier, and they have 3 Michelin stars.
Service, please.
I can't wait to meet a young chef with such an impressive pedigree.
Hello, Louis.
Gordon Ramsay. Nice to meet you.
Enchanté.
Enchanté.
And this is the team?
Yeah.
To help realise his dream, Lewick's handpicked an impeccably trained brigade. Sous chef Jeffrey has worked in restaurants with both 1 and 2 Michelin stars.
Did you work with Lewick in France?
No.
No.
I came basically here because it's a very good opportunity to work with some of the 3 Michelin stars.
Regis also has a Michelin star studied background.
How long have you been cooking?
8 years in France,
uh-huh.
And in a different country, you know.
And so does the junior of the team, Nicola.
And Nicola, whereabouts in France are you from?
Brittany.
Brittany?
Nantes.
Got a good football team there, huh? Yeah. But now you support Celtic or Rangers?
FC Nantes.
FC Nantes.
Oh,
hey, you're in Inverness, for God's sake. You've got to support a proper team.
And Gerard's not letting the side down either. His previous jobs were at Michelin star level as well.
Gerard, do you have a Scottish girlfriend?
Yes, my French accent is a good point.
1,400 miles from the French Riviera, Lewick has created a mini French stronghold in Inverness.
And no one's Scottish in the kitchen?
No, no Scottish.
No Scottish?
There was some, but not anymore.
Did you sack them?
No. The first time when I came in the kitchen, I switched off the microwave. Put it in a car park, and 3 days after, I was by myself.
They got the message?
Yeah, because they were using microwave all the time.
Oh, God.
Powder for stock, deep frying everything, even fondant potatoes. So I had to build a new team, okay. Which is good.
Lewick's determined that his dream team is going to get him his very own Michelin star.
A bit like Roman Abramovich when he wanted to get the Premiership title. Yeah. He went round and got the best manager, uh-huh. The best football players, and then brought them all over to Chelsea.
Yeah.
Fantastic. Off from Liverpool. That's good.
Yeah, all done.
I think if you can get a Michelin star, that should be great for us.
We are looking to achieve like 1 Michelin star to start with. Why not 2? And, you know.
This is new.
Even the fridge is top of the league.
It's wow. A big walking fridge.
Fucking hell, look at the size of it. Yeah. It's like a 1-bedroom flat.
Yeah. And the produce is the very best. Flying vegetables in from France is over the top, even for me. But the local shellfish is really top-notch.
They are amazing.
They've been fished on Skye.
When they come down to London, they're definitely not that fresh, I can assure you. That is incredible.
Fuck me. They've got the best of everything here. I mean, really the best of everything. Someone must be paying a small fucking fortune to run this place.
And that someone is multimillionaire Barry Larson. Hot from his 600-acre private shooting estate. He made his fortune from the catering business, but it wasn't exactly fine dining.
Morning, Julie, how are you?
This is the man who brought Kentucky Fried Chicken, Wimpy and Harry Ramsden's to Scotland.
All right, we'll see you in a minute.
And now he's invested nearly £2 million trying to prove he can make fine dining finger-licking good.
It sounds amazing. The sort of dream team that you've put together.
Yep.
Slightly concerned about the expense involved in that because dream teams don't come cheap.
No, they don't.
You haven't got any grey hair.
So no, I've got some.
Yeah.
Well, you're hiding it very well. Unless you die the fucking thing.
No, I don't die. Not yet. but no, it's expensive. You know what the school is.
Yeah, big time. Have you owned hotels?
No, I haven't owned I haven't owned hotels before. We've had various restaurants, fast food chains that we've built up, sold out.
Really?
Family restaurants that we still run. But obviously at a different, completely different level.
I mean, a fast food restaurant's miles away from anything to do with fine dining.
Yeah, but, you know, you still want to produce quality for the spend.
It sounds fantastic, but this place is costing Barry over £8,000 a week on food and staff costs alone. And they seem to have forgotten the three most important things in the restaurant business. Customers, customers, customers. 4 days a week, the restaurant's dead. And every night it's empty, it's another big dent in Barry's investment and Luik's ego.
Sometimes you get zero.
Really?
Yeah.
Must be hard that when it's zero, no?
Yeah.
Especially with all these team here.
It's a nightmare for us.
Does it hurt?
Yeah, a bit, yeah.
You've got the team, but you want to play. You're ready to go. But...
Oh, yeah.
That's difficult.
We are like dogs, you know, when they go shooting.
Yeah.
We are ready.
Luik's hungry for success, but the locals aren't biting.
Can you do me a favour? Can you read that out for me?
Oh, gosh, I can't say that. What, Bollinger of Jerusalem artichoke?
Do you know what that is?
One glance at his menu, and I think I've spotted the problem before I've even tasted the food.
Not sure.
Declinization of salmon.
Baragoulis, Joss.
That sounds good.
How's your goulis?
Yeah.
Baragoulis.
That doesn't sound very appetising.
I'll probably order that one.
What do you think that means?
This food may appeal to the connoisseurs in the south of France.
I haven't got the foggiest.
But this is Scotland's smallest city.
Right, yeah. Yeah? Yeah. Would you eat that?
Would I eat it?
Aye.
You can't even eat it, so you don't know what it is.
Thanks very much.
Thank you.
Nice to meet you.
Barry and Luik want Michelin-level success, but I'm afraid they've lost sight of the basics.
You are an impatient bastard.
Yeah.
You want it, and you want to get your shopping trolley and go along and get that and get that, and you know, I can see it in your eyes. You've had a lot of success beforehand, bringing all these things in together.
Yeah.
It's not the perfect recipe for an instant hit.
Right.
I'm just worried that you don't fall into the same fucking trap that I did, and I lost a lot of money.
Right.
It was a proud day for me when I opened Amaryllis in my hometown, Glasgow. We got off to a great start, and within our first year, we'd won a Michelin star. But as the menu became more elaborate, the diners started to dwindle. The food was so fancy, it put off the locals. They stopped coming, and I was forced to close Amaryllis down.
It's a bit of a deja vu for me, and I'm concerned that you may be running too quickly, too soon. You know, you're in danger. Oh, fuck it.
It's going too far. Yeah.
That happened to me after 12 years at the top.
I saw, sir.
There's no doubt in Luik's talent. It's his lack of experience that worries me.
One scallop, never three.
It's his first ever head chef's job. There's always a big, big trap they fall in.
Have you finished?
Where they try to do too much too soon and almost try to be sort of competitive and thinking that what they saw in their previous kitchen, which was in a three Michelin star, I've got to be better than that. And that's where a lot of young chefs fail.
Could you check table 10 for me, please? You put the name and everything, huh?
It's my second day at La Riviera, a top restaurant with no customers. So if the locals aren't eating here, where are they eating?
Busy for lunch?
Fuck me, £5.95 for two courses, starter and main.
Inverness is a fast-growing city, and the restaurant market is clearly thriving.
£7.95 is fucking cheap, isn't it? Now, look, early supper menu, two courses, £9.95.
I've asked Luik to serve me dinner from his a la carte menu, which costs £34 for two courses.
Yeah. With that team in there and the produce in the fridge, it's to die for. So it should be a great dinner. I'm looking forward to this one.
One scallop to follow one duck. The breast pink.
Yes, yes.
Allez, let's go.
This is your canapé. You have an olive medallion and a cheese beignet.
Canapés and a pre-starter. This is ambitious food for London, let alone Inverness.
Potato soup with wasabi. Very creamy. Very, very rich. I'm excited about the food, but I don't feel comfortable sat here.
You are like a painter. You need a good eye. You know, like the paint, he will put something like black here and not here, because for him it doesn't look right.
Okay, let's go. One scallops, table 9.
Very complicated. A lot of combinations of flavors going on.
For me, the golden rule is always keep it simple.
You're tasting a broad bean and white asparagus and a citrus vinaigrette, a confit tomato, fennel seeds, fennel flowers, chervil, salad, parmesan. There must be 20 things going on this plate. And then, yeah, that looks fantastic. But didn't do anything with it.
Next up, duck en deux services.
This is a duck leg. Decided to make it a ravioli on duck leg for the 9.
A good 10, 12 flavors on the plate again. It's just confusion. And your mind is sort of working overtime to try and understand what's happening.
Okay, service please.
A main course served in two parts. That's just pretentious.
Almost like someone is uncontrollable and almost like a little bit carried away and overexcited and nothing saying, just stop, come back. Ooh la la. Is that all for me?
Yes, it's all for
me. Luik seems desperate to impress. Next, he'll be telling me how to eat it.
If I may, to recommend you the order, you've got the tiramisu first, please, then the floating island, then you'll have the souffle, then the sorbet, finally the cornetto with marmalade.
Yeah. What a load of bollocks. Next, we'll be told which direction to pee in because of the fucking salmon in the river.
Technically, flavours were amazing. The scallops were delicious. The light vinaigrette. Did it need the parmesan? Did it need the flowers? And do you need that many flavors to make it work?
I won't change anything on the flavor. I think the way we work, the product bring to the guests the flavors that I want.
Your personality has to be comfortable on the plate. And I see a lot of uneasiness on the plate. I don't know if you're confident enough in what you're doing. And I've got to be very honest because this is very crucial. But this has to work.
Mm-hmm.
Barry, what do you think?
When you think about it, it's probably right that he has to just find his own style.
Barry's acting more like a besotted sugar daddy than Luik's boss.
You take on somebody like that and you're taking them on because of their capabilities and their ambition. And, you know, the last thing I want to try and do is restrain that ambition and what he's doing. I'm not a chef and I couldn't do what he does. I'm not really in a position to criticise.
One seabass, one grill.
But I am. This place isn't even breaking even. And yet Barry's forking out $4,500 a week just on staff.
Allez, service.
It's no way to run a successful business.
Barry's in love with you.
No, you're not too.
No, but he's in love with your food.
Yeah, I think you like it, yeah.
He's never going to be your critic. And what I've got to understand is where is your critic coming from? Who's telling you to stop? That's it. Send it.
When I think it's all right, don't touch it anymore.
It goes.
No wonder his food's over the top. Now I want to see how he runs his kitchen. Scalpel.
Tweezers.
As every plate journeys around the kitchen, each of his 7 chefs adds another flourish. And all this unnecessary fussing is wasting time and money.
Hurry up now. Yeah, all done.
There's so many hands that are going on round the kitchen. The plate, is that normal for it to go round? Can they not finish anything?
Then use my sauce. The same for the lobsters, I need my sauce. Okay. You put the plate under the grill and I sauce, okay?
Service, please. Service.
Up. One is missing. No, it's okay. It's okay, sorry. Okay.
Yes, yes.
Fucking hell, it feels like we've done 250. And all we've cooked in the last 2.5 hours is 10.
Service, please.
I felt that I wanted to just say stop. What you've got at the beginning was just enough for me.
You prefer something more simple?
Simple because the ingredients you've got are phenomenal.
He needs to let his food speak for itself. His approach feels outdated and pretentious.
Is it easier if we maybe cook a dish, like cook the scallops and look at the difference and go through it together that way? Right, now what should we do? Scallops?
Now?
Whatever.
I've got a few things to do first.
Okay.
For the guests tonight, and I'll be with you.
If the restaurant was full, I could understand his arrogance. But it's hemorrhaging cash, and no one seems to care.
It's almost like the barricades are up and, you know, nothing's going to get through, because all I want to do is do the dish together and look at the different stages we're taking out to make it more appealing. But it doesn't seem to sort of sink in. I only want to be part of the team. Just let me in. Being hard ass is, you know, nice, but when you're in this situation with over-complex food and no direction, I'd fucking grab that kind of insight if I was in his shoes.
The owner, trust me completely. I can do what I want, whatever I want. So it was a deal between us. A carte blanche on whatever I do.
Louis's behaving like a spoilt brat. So as a last resort, I'll try his brigade.
Is there something you can, you know, work closely with Louis? Yeah?
You cannot make the food too complex. You can help us as well, I'm sure.
I want to help. Yeah. Definitely. Let me fucking in. Yeah. Yes?
First, I'm going to tackle the language barrier.
I'm going to have to get you speaking fluent Scottish. Dirty wee bastard.
Dirty wee bastard.
No, too far.
Dirty wee bastard.
It's getting there. Dirty wee bastard.
Sorry?
It's fluent in Scottish now.
All right.
So when someone upsets him in the high street...
Dirty wee bastard. Oh, piss off.
Oh, piss off? No, piss off.
Piss off out of my way.
Oh, fucking hell.
Fucking hell, fucking hell, yeah.
It's already my third day, but nothing's sinking in. Surely Louis can't ignore the evidence if it's staring him in the face. This isn't a meal for six. All this is dinner for one. At La Riviera.
Looks like a fucking feast for a king. Henry VIII. It's quite interesting when you start from one end and go all the way right to the very end. It helps you to identify where you can just draw back a little bit and look at the whole balance of exactly what you're doing.
And people have to understand that they are here to enjoy it, so they have to spend a bit more of time on the table, like... Just say, okay, we've got 2.5 hours to enjoy it.
I couldn't eat all that. I'd have to stop halfway, I think. I'd stop halfway. Yes?
I don't know. If I was not able to eat all this, I wouldn't do it.
What Louis can't get into his stubborn French brain is that refusing to trust his ingredients isn't just putting off his customers. It's also a turn-off for Michelin inspectors. Maybe I can convince Barry. It is his money, after all.
Recommend me a whiskey.
I'll try to explain in terms that any hot-blooded Scotsman will understand.
And one for Barry, please, because
yes,
obviously Barry's paying, so... Can I just have a touch of ice in there, please?
Sure.
Yeah, thank you. Can I have a touch of soda in there, please?
No, because you're going to spoil the complicated the drinks.
Are you suggesting or telling me?
Doing both. No way soda on the malt whiskies. There's no way. No.
Let me just say something. You're absolutely right. You don't fuck with things that are good. And the first thing I said to Livik about the food, when you've got quality ingredients, let them speak for themselves. And when you've got something as good as that, that speaks volumes, doesn't need anything else, no fucking parsley, no chervil, no bay leaf, no fucking fruit garden, nothing, just bang, get it out. Do you understand?
Yeah, I do.
Barry seems to be getting it, and I've got an idea that just might convince his chef.
The Saint-Jacques dish. I want you to cook that, and I'm going to cook a Saint-Jacques dish alongside you.
There's a lot of way to do it, I mean, like...
Yeah, no, of course, it's just I'm 38, I'm 10 years older than you, and so it's not because I'm fucking 10 times better than you, I just want to make you understand how I think.
Nah.
Yeah?
Okay.
Okay, Monterey.
What Louis doesn't know is that I've invited ex-AA inspector David Young to judge the dishes for himself. And what he won't know is whose is whose. My Saint-Jacques dish has just four simple ingredients. As well as the scallops, it has a cauliflower puree and a caper and raisin dressing.
How long for you?
30 seconds.
Louis's dish has at least 14 different flavours.
So you've got the new season asparagus, white asparagus, with roasted scallops. You've got a fennel artichoke and anise jus. And I mix it with the fennel milk, OK? You've got the Parmesan crisps, and you've got the broom.
Thank you, Doctor.
It's time to let Luik into my little secret.
I've arranged for the inspector, mm-hmm. the AA guy, mm-hmm. to come and taste our food. Thank you. Go, darling, please.
So they're going to make like a competition.
Go, darling.
Food inspectors are feared and revered by chefs all over the country. If they judge your food worthy of Michelin stars or AA rosettes, the reward is a place on the gastronomic map.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thanks.
And ideally, customers beating a path to your door.
Thank you.
Will he prefer Luik's elaborate plateful or my simpler rendition?
This particular one has much more visual impact. I get the feeling that the dish is going to taste of exactly what was described to me, whereas this one looks a little bit over-garnished. There's a bit of a muddle of different types of flavours.
Inspectors like David can make or break a restaurant's reputation.
Introduce you to Luik.
Hi. Nice to meet you.
If Luik is going to gain a coveted Michelin star, his food really needs to be worthy of four rosettes.
How difficult, David, is it to get four AA rosettes?
Well, it's very difficult because, to put it into context, as at this moment, there are only two AA four rosette restaurants in Scotland.
In the whole of Scotland?
In the whole of Scotland.
Is it a four-star dish, what you've eaten?
This one, Gordon?
Yes.
No. No, this particular dish would be somewhere between two and three rosettes, mm-hmm. whereas this dish would be probably four rosettes. Mm-hmm. The combination of the cauliflower and caper puree just absolutely lifted the dish into a different dimension. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Whereas this one, some of the flavours were overcomplicated, to be frank about it. Mm-hmm. And it may be just a case of sometimes less is actually more.
Luik has taken the news badly.
Ne m'abandonne pas.
He thinks I've stitched him up. Anglo-French relations have hit an all-time low. But time is running out at the Riviera.
It's got to work, hasn't it? It's your first head chef job. You can't afford to fuck that.
Will I ever make princes out of this colony of frogs?
Smile! Yes. Fucking hell, it doesn't cost anything in Scotland.
I'm getting towards the end of my week at La Riviera, and I don't know if Luik is still speaking to me. Last night he reacted badly when an AA inspector confirmed that his food was over-fussy.
What was the first thing you thought about this morning after yesterday with the inspector? Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. What was the one message you learned from it?
Now, I had your advice, I had his advice as well, so one, you can say maybe he's wrong, mm-hmm. two, you start to take care of that thing and maybe I am wrong, mm-hmm. So...
It's a difficult thing to accept.
The French franc has finally dropped. It's been hard for Luik, but he's already changing his game plan. He's come up with a new, much simpler idea for the scallop dish.
It looks fucking brilliant. Uh-huh. And what I can identify now, uh-huh. I know there's apple because you kept the green on there. I know there's rocket. I know there's pumpkin seed. And it makes me feel comfortable because I know what I'm about to eat.
Yeah.
I can identify what you're doing. That's delicious. Everything that goes on the plate has to have a reason. Yeah. Not for this, but for here.
For the palate.
Yeah, for the palate. And what you've just done there, Luik, you've given your food clear insight.
Okay. I understand.
It's not three, four, five rosette for me. I'd be happy eating that anywhere, you know that. Mm. Where's that fucking inspector? Putain. Fucking hell. Hallelujah. I've just taken fucking France.
Now Luik has finally swallowed his pride. We can begin to move forward. With his team behind him, maybe he has a chance of achieving his ultimate goal.
You told me that you wanted a Michelin star. And at first, I didn't think that was possible, you know that, because of how things got so complicated. But with this here, there's no two ways about it. It's definitely worth the star. I respect Luik for taking it on board, yeah. because it's a fucking hard lesson. Very hard lesson, but, you know, it's got to work, hasn't it? It's your first head chef job. Mm. You can't afford to fuck that. Yep. Crucial. You've got the right training. Now you've got the perfect position to do it.
But winning over the kitchen is only half the battle. Carolyn is the maitre d', and she's also Louis's girlfriend. She's responsible for writing the elaborate menus, and have already discovered that the locals haven't got a clue what they mean. It's time to turn the tables.
Read that for me.
Crunching pepper head with mashed tatties. Nice. Dirty wee bastard.
To prove a point, I've given them a menu of classic Scottish dishes.
What do you think it is? Something sexy? something spicy? Tatties.
Tatties.
Louis, what do you think that one is there? This one here.
Bread is for far, and we talk about in salad of greens. No idea at all.
What is Queen Mary
Tart? Queen Mary Tart.
Queen Mary Tart. Yeah.
And?
Whipped Canadian cream.
Ah, no, crumble crunch.
Do you have any idea what I'm trying to say?
It's impossible to choose anything you don't understand.
Exactly. That's exactly
what
it is.
It's difficult for make a choice when you have this one, because it's...
Yes, that's... You know? It's difficult for fucking Scotland to understand you guys.
Yeah,
that's what I'm trying to say.
Same. Yeah, he's same, yes.
So it's less intimidating if you have an assortment of salmon, you know, a selection of mandarin. Do you understand what I'm trying to say?
Yeah. At last, I'm getting somewhere.
Just look at what you're taking to the table. And... fucking hell. You know, it's like you're a librarian.
Yep.
You should see what it's like when the table are sat and six of them are looking in here.
Yep.
You've lost everybody.
Yeah.
There's no dinner anymore because everyone's behind a brick wall.
Yep.
You can simplify the whole thing. Yep. Just one beautiful open card, starters, mains. Yep. So everything going down there has simplified it.
And it's not just the menus that need lighting up.
Smile, mon ami. Smile. He's far better looking when he's smiling.
Ah,
smile! Fucking hell, it doesn't cost anything in Scotland.
Well tried.
Well tried, yeah. Oh, fucking hell. Throw him in the river. We're supposed to be in a restaurant, not a Sunday school church service. Where's my Bible?
Barry's grasped the nettle and has radical plans to transform the dining room.
We're going to take this column away.
Yep.
We're going to take the raised area away at the back on that side. So we've got
at a cost of £35,000.
The arches over the doors we're going to square off.
Yeah.
And then it's all panel
all
the way around. Some nice artwork.
It doesn't look that bad, does it?
And it doesn't look... I don't think it looks particularly...
Yeah, it's not glamorous, but it's not
glamorous.
It's not shitty.
No, but it's just not. I just think it doesn't look right.
But I've got a low-cost idea, which I think will give La Riviera a unique selling point.
I said less salad.
I'd like you to start thinking about having a table in the kitchen where you have locals to come and sit and eat.
Yeah.
It starts to break up the sort of wall that, you know, sometimes you have when you come to a strange new country.
As I've discovered, having a chef's table in the kitchen is a great way to bring customers into your world and keeping the chefs on their toes. And this would be the first restaurant in Scotland to have one.
I think this would be the best place.
Yep,
this is definitely
there.
Yeah, just in a corner, and they will see
everything.
Yeah.
And it can help create something exciting in Inverness. Can you imagine the buzz going around town? The chef's table could be a way of showing off and establishing your reputation here and be first.
Yeah. I think it's an exciting idea.
Yeah, it is.
Yeah.
I mean, for once, we're going to see how do the people
react to your food.
Yes. If it's no good, I mean, like, just to throw it.
Yeah.
You have to take care about this.
Hopefully they won't do that. Super.
But it all costs money. And although the chef table is a great investment, until they've got customers coming in, they need to make economies elsewhere.
Crab, foie gras, and hand-dived scallops. Which are king scallops. So, I mean, the Rolls Royce of ingredients. I mean, everything's here. Fucking hell.
Louis needs to do what I did when I started out. Learn to use good, cheap cuts to put together an inspiring menu.
Do you ever use a shin, Louis? No? Ox tongue.
Making something exquisite from a shin of beef or an ox tongue takes a lot of skill.
About the size of my feet.
And it's a great way to identify talent.
Right. Oxtail. You and you, Bridges. a little competition. I want you to cook a dish, come up with something really exciting, and then Lyric and myself will look at it, and the most tastiest, delicious dish will put on a lunch menu. And for me, the most important thing about this is always a sign of a very, very good cook to turn something very, very cheap into something quite special. So, Bridges, take it to bed and think about it.
Next morning, I'm pleased to see the young chefs have taken their oxtail challenge seriously.
Pasta?
Yes.
And
poultry, yeah.
And so it's very, you know?
Yeah, nice and long.
Very long.
Yeah.
Yep, roll it, put it back into oxtail shape from the beginning.
That's a good idea.
Yeah. Juice reduction.
Mm-hmm.
Reduction.
Yeah.
Glass.
Like a font.
Yeah.
The oxtail dishes for the lunch menu are almost ready, and they've each cost about a quid to put together.
So this is braised oxtail with winter vegetable, braised gem lettuce.
Dishes like these are not only highly profitable, but bringing together great Scottish produce with French flair is a winning formula.
I like the jus and just a bit of Australian.
Yes, it tastes delicious with the white root vegetables. It made it feel earthy and together. Yeah. Who's next?
And despite what Louis thinks, simplifying his dishes will actually make them more likely to win awards.
I've never had oxtail and sesame seed together before.
Michelin inspectors never reveal their criteria, but I know from experience that beautifully cooked food is not enough.
Next.
Inspectors look for good quality ingredients, ideally regional, and definitely in season.
And I put carrots, celery.
This idea is great.
And the balance of flavors is crucial.
Very rich.
It needs a salad.
Yeah.
Because it's quite rich.
And what I like is that if you put the salad just next to and not on a plate like this, you can choose.
Thank
but
you.
First and foremost, don't confuse a Michelin inspector's palate by putting too many ingredients on the plate.
Never expected anyone French to come up with a jack and potato stuffed.
Thank you.
The simpler, the better.
What do you think?
Brilliant idea.
Mm-hmm. Flavours are very good. What you've managed to do is to bring out the true flavour of oxtail. Bovol.
Thank you.
Okay, Mel Gibson.
Any one of these dishes would be worthy of a place on the lunch menu, but we're choosing just one. I want to see if Luke and I will agree on the winner.
I'm going to touch my plate, which I'd like on the lunch menu.
Uh-huh.
And you touch the plate after three. Yeah?
Okay.
One, two, three.
Equal.
Bravo. Well done. well done.
Let's go. It was real and authentic Scottish food.
Yep.
That's, I think, he understood, really understood where we want to go.
With Luke leading the way, we're ready to relaunch the restaurant.
For me, it's a critical stage for any restaurant is to get a lunch full.
And if our customers have an enjoyable lunch, chances are they'll be back for a more expensive a la carte dinner.
And when they leave with a bloody good lunch, good prices, I can guarantee, by the time 5 o'clock in the afternoon hits, you know, they've told 100 people, go there for dinner because I had a fantastic lunch. I want to see if we can push this starter, main and dessert, 1 hour.
Yeah.
As well as the new oxtail dish, the menu will include mackerel, pheasant and goat's cheese ravioli, venison from Barry's estate, tuna and the cheapest cut of pork.
Customers sometimes are scared about belly of pork, thinking fat, greasy. We've taken the fat off, rolled it, spiced on a bed of spinach. It's a caramelised onion puree. Have a taste if you wish.
And I've got some other ideas to give Scottish traditional dishes a modern twist.
This is a soup that doesn't look pretty, but tastes amazing. They wouldn't expect the Frenchman to make a cookie soup, which is a really nice way of putting your identification on it. Louis, just an idea for the rice pudding.
Yeah.
And we grew up with this kind of food, so we can go a little bit further, caramelised pineapple, mango, or even marinate the prunes in a nice malt whiskey.
Yeah.
Yeah?
The kitchen's finally turning out the kind of food that I know will definitely appeal to the locals. And even the waiters have promised to try and smile. But there's one more thing to complete the transformation.
You've got to come with me now, because we're going to become even more Scottish.
Any ideas yet? Bridges, have you ever taken your knickers off before?
No.
No. Chance to show Amelash your Scotch eggs.
Okay.
It's time for Lewick and his small colony of French comrades to surrender themselves to the Scots.
Fucking hell. The things I'll do to get the arrogant French to become a little bit more Scottish is amazing. You know that? It's corn!
How are you going to tell me that?
We don't wear pants underneath our belts.
That's wonderful.
Very hot. It's very sexy.
Attendez. Hey, there's 25 very important guests coming for lunch. Yes? But some really good news. Uh-huh. They're all women.
Nice.
Very powerful women.
Super.
If they can impress 25 influential local businesswomen, they'll be the talk of the town.
Do you guys have the office tail on this? Yes.
Double 2-4 guests, 1 potato soup, vegetarian, 3 oxtail, 2 follow, 1 gnocchi, 2 venison, 1 tuna. Nicolas,
oui,
you don't start off, you give me a cookie. Okay. Agis, I want to 2 mackerel, 2 ravioli, 1 oxtail, okay?
Watch your legs. Watch your front legs.
At last, Lewick's team are beginning to dance to a different tune. The food looks really good, clear and simple.
Fucking fast. And everyone's coping really, really well. So it's the first time I've actually seen a real taste of Scotland in this kitchen.
Just after this, you have to go for 2-4.
Lewick's on his way to the top of the Premier League.
Allez, go.
So wonderfully presented. It's gorgeous.
And judging by the reaction of his fans, he's definitely scored.
Absolutely divine. Just perfect. Absolutely perfect. Beautiful presentation.
You couldn't fault anything, really.
I would imagine normally this sort of food, you'd be talking at least a couple of hours for lunch, but to get something like this in that time scale, brilliant. It's beautiful.
You have tried, you win this. And Loto, okay, it's for you, a present.
Thank you. Excuse me. What the fuck is that? Who is that?
I think it's a big chef.
And what is that there?
Balls,
yeah. Trust me, I have a big pair of bollocks. Allez les bleus.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Chin chin.
Chin.
Lewick and his team have come a long way this week, and if he sticks to my keep it simple mantra, then I think La Riviera might be on the right track for a Michelin star.
Outside. Just for the ladies, Regis. To understand that you really are part of Scotland now, we're all going to turn around. Okay. Turn around.
Oh, here you go.
Turn around. Ready? 1, 2, 3, go!
On my last visit to La Riviera, Chef Lewick had simplified his food by reducing the number of ingredients. Barry had spruced up the dining room. The restaurant was heaving, and I left it with every chance of becoming a success and obtaining that elusive Michelin star. In the 2 years since I was last here, La Riviera has been renamed Abstract. I wonder what else has changed.
Marinated calamari, Chinese way, potato foam, salty peanut ice cream. It sounds like the fucking menu's upside down. Is that a dessert or a starter? Fuck me.
How are you?
Very well, thank you. How are you?
Not too bad. Family well?
Yeah, very well indeed, thank you. This looks nice and new.
My God, it's lunchtime. But Abstract is empty. What's wrong?
And how many have you got booked for lunch?
Lunch, we don't open for lunch here now. We just opened next door.
So you've actually opened a new restaurant in there?
Yeah, we opened Contrast. In about the end of the second week in June this year. Just a brasserie. So it's to try and give us the balance between the fine dining and something more simple.
Bizarre. Instead of serving simple lunches in here, as I advised, Barry's opened an entirely new restaurant.
We just thought we're doing the lunches there. It's really busy there.
Yeah.
We'll close this one.
Barry says turnover at Abstract is down 27% in the past year, although it is popular in the evening.
Big question. Michelin star?
We never got it, and that was it. We just keep working hard and see what happens this year.
I thought by simplifying the menu, I'd put them on course for a star. is Lewick over-elaborating in the kitchen again.
How are you?
Fine, and you?
Yeah, good to see you. Well,
yeah.
I'm sorry to hear about the Michelin star. I thought that would have
that's life, huh?
Arrived a year ago.
You've done well without the star, and the business is running very well.
New dishes on the menu? Marinated calamari, Chinese way. Potato foam, salted peanut ice cream.
Yeah.
Oh, dear.
This must be a vegetarian delight, a giblet club sandwich. Mm-hmm. What is that?
Mashed giblet.
But so... in Inverness now. Mm-hmm. Not in Edinburgh or London or New York. If you said to someone, you know, fancy a club sandwich, you know, they would expect some fucking chicken, tomato, mayonnaise. Where do you get these ideas from?
I don't want to be like my neighbours.
I feel like I'm just preparing lunch for Silence of the Lambs.
Brown hair and black pudding, pig's trotter carpaccio.
Sounds like everything's intensified tenfold, but I just hope it comes off.
Some of Lewick's menu seems very strange indeed. It's more Frankenstein than Franco-Scottish.
So that's the club sandwich.
Thank you.
Then we serve with the roasted partridge.
Uh-huh.
Ably risotto with plum and white mushrooms. And just a normal jus.
It's a shame. He's a talented chef, but he's still trying too hard.
And it's only one or two bites. At the end of the dish, you're satisfied. Because you didn't have a lot to eat.
I can guarantee there won't be anywhere in quite possibly Europe that will be serving a giblet club sandwich, so we can relax on that front.
If Lewick carries on like this, he can forget the Michelin star. Maybe the brasserie isn't the only reason takings are down at Abstract. Lewick tells me his customers like the giblet club sandwich, but surely not. I'm going to unleash it onto the streets of Inverness.
Yes, of course, darling. Would you like to know what it is?
Yes.
It's a giblet club sandwich.
Oh, lovely.
Right, you fire away. You like that?
Yes.
Lovely. Right, this. It's actually a giblet club sandwich. Would you order it if you saw it on a menu in a restaurant?
That's absolutely no way.
No.
Sounds gross.
What is it?
Giblets.
I don't think I would order it.
You wouldn't order it?
I wouldn't order it.
Would you like to have a little taste? Giblet club sandwich? Giblet club sandwich, think about it.
No.
Madam?
Who's giblet?
Who's giblet? It's weird because I feel a little bit sorry for him as a chef because he's very talented, but he doesn't know where to draw that line.
However, Lewick is getting something right. He finally took my advice about simple food, but not at Abstract. He's doing it here in the brasserie, and the place is heaving.
It's nice in here, huh?
Yeah.
How many tables?
We can sit 70 people.
And what style of food is it?
More simple food. Cheaper, obviously.
You've gone simple?
Yeah.
No.
Yeah, I can do simple.
No.
Can be simple and modern sometimes. $5.95 for lunch. Two course lunch.
$5.95. Go on.
Only fresh produce.
That's amazing. What kind of things are on the menu for $5.95?
You've got some Scottish ling. Very good.
Monkfish tail at £12.
Yeah.
Fucking hell, no wonder it's so busy.
We're still making good money. That brings people back in the evening.
Contrast offers great value dishes made with fresh ingredients. I only wish he'd done this next door at Abstract.
So what did you have for dinner?
The belly of pork.
And how many times have you been here?
Twice.
Lovely.
I've been about 6 times.
Really?
Yeah, I like it.
Wow, that's great. I think it's beautiful. Yeah. How many times have you been to Abstract?
Once.
How long have you been?
Oh, about a year ago.
Why haven't you been back there?
I'll be honest, but I felt it was a bit stiff.
Mm-hmm. It's very relaxed in here.
Yes.
Nice
yes.
And casual.
Yes.
Yeah, and you come for the value?
Yeah, this is probably about the 7th time now, yeah. And I've recommended it as well.
You should be on the payroll. He always made it quite clear from day one that lunch was his headache because he couldn't quite make the standard of fine dining for the lunch menu. They didn't want to eat plain food. Well, they do because this place... is a big success.
Saturday, 4th of November. Four. 100 for dinner. Another 100 for dinner.
Contrast success is startling, with a turnover of £250,000 in its first 4 months. But why didn't Barry do this in Abstract and save himself £80,000 building a new brasserie?
It's been phenomenally busy, but... there's something really weird going on because that's getting less busy in Abstract over there. In contrast, seems to be the draw. I'm leaving this morning, but Barry and Lewick have dropped a bomb. They're opening a third restaurant together in Edinburgh, modelled on, you've guessed it, abstract.
Nice. And then that's your UK.
What about? This is a first for you in terms of investing in the business, in terms of partnership?
Yes, Yeah.
And expenditure?
Probably, you know, we're about 400,000 on the, you know, working shop capital. Fit, probably another 100,000 opening expenses and stuff like that.
So half a million. Big one.
Yep.
In terms of Edinburgh, Edinburgh's a tough market.
I would play it fucking safe.
Yep.
Safe, safe, safe. Whilst it's really exciting to go down and play with the fucking big boys in Edinburgh in a major fucking, you know, city, if I was in your shoes, I'd be doing something simple. I'd be going in with an upmarket version of contrast, not abstract. I so want it to work, you know that? If you stick to those lines, you'll fucking be a massive success.
Mm-hmm. For sure, we'll have to
simplify.
Yeah. We know that.
Yeah,
we've got your advice on your opinion on it now, which I think is great. And you know, Louis and I have a chat about it.
Perfect. Good
thank
luck.
You.
Yes.
Thank you,
Barry.
Thank you once again. Appreciate it.
You're such a little fucker. You know that. If they keep it simple and win the Michelin star, they've got every chance of their business being really successful. But forget the quirkiness. No restaurant's going to be successful with a fucking giblet club sandwich. Anywhere in the world, let alone fucking Scotland.